So here we are talking about reforms that are required to sustain growth in India. And this is an interesting juncture to be talking about growth and to be talking about the future as far as reforms are concerned. Because the last surgical strike that the government mounted on us was in the form of demonetization on the 8th of November. And I think there is consensus that it is going to impact growth, at least in the short term. What is short term going to mean is a question mark at this point in time. Does it mean one quarter? Does it mean two quarters? Or is it going to be longer, perhaps, is the question that we're all grappling with. I can see Mr. Lavasa coming in, and I think it'll be crucial to understand what assumptions the government is working with in terms of growth, because if you look at the figures that have come in from the Reserve Bank of India, the RBI has said that it is revising its outlook for GVA from 7.6% to 7.1%, and people do seem to believe that that may perhaps be a tad optimistic, but of course the jury is still out. The Finance Secretary, Mr. Lavasa, joins us as well. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us here this evening. So let's kick things off with the Finance Secretary, Mr. Lavasa. I'm going to throw the first question to you, sir, because we're talking about growth and we're talking about... He's settled, sir. They're used to being ambushed. So let me get the microphone across to you. I think you have one right next to you, Mr. Lavasa. As I pointed out, you know, the jury is out on the implications for growth in the short term on account of demonetization. The Reserve Bank says 7.6% to 7.1%. You've got 45 days before the budget, sir. So there have to be certain assumptions that you're working with. What are those assumptions when we talk about growth?
Well, first of all, I'm sure that you are not interested that I should be held up for breach of privilege. But yes, there are various estimates. A variety of experts have revised their assessment and different numbers have been forecast. I think the assessment is still to be made. The jury is not yet out. And I don't see the reason why we should be looking at a number which is much below what had been anticipated.
Mm-hmm.
So going forward, as the period of 30th December ends, a very calm assessment has to be made on what kind of impact this slowing down, as it were, has made. Certainly, certain areas have been impacted. There is no denying the fact, and largely the informal sectors of the economy, perhaps there has been an effect, especially in those cases where a lot of dealing used to be taking place in cash.
Right.
So I think at the end of December would be the appropriate time when assessments will be made. Incidentally, some of the numbers that we have looked at in terms of tax collections, yes, etc., up to the 30th of November, they have not shown any downward trajectory.
Okay, so till the 30th of November, at least as far as tax is concerned, you seem to be okay. But sir, if I can put my second question to you, and I hope you won't respond with this will be amount to breach of privilege if you actually answer that question. But give me a sense of what we should realistically expect come the 30th of December in terms of remonetization, in terms of lifting of the caps on withdrawals. Should we expect that on the 30th of December or the 1st of January, we will actually see the government and the Reserve Bank of India lift the withdrawal limits, lift those caps? What will be the picture in terms of remonetization?
There will be a review which will be done after 30th of December, and whatever steps are required to be taken to bring things back to normalcy, I think they will be decided once that review is complete.
So should we expect a stimulus in 45 days in the budget? Because that's the big expectation now. Since we're talking about growth, sir, that's the theme here. What should we realistically expect then in terms of stimulating the economy?
You know, if you look at the budget numbers, for example, for 16-17, this is perhaps for the first time that this year, up to November, more than 65% of the planned spending has already taken place. So in terms of numbers, this would mean that compared to last year, more than 75,000 crores of rupees have been spent on what is known as the plan side. So typically, in many sectors of development, whether it is social sectors pertaining to education or rural employment generation or road building, etc., these are some of the sectors, including education, by the way, in which there has been a considerable step up in public spending compared to last year. And I would imagine that the same trend should continue.
Okay, I'll give you a break for just a second. I'll come to Mr. Mitra now and talk about what we should expect in terms of infrastructure spending, because that seems to be the lever that the government will employ yet again to try and stimulate the economy. I know that Mr. Gadkari sets very stiff targets for you and your ministry, sir. What should we expect realistically? I know that there have been changes that have been made, for instance, in the hybrid annuity model. We have seen a lot of the stalled projects moving back, coming back on track. There have been several changes that your ministry has taken forward. Realistically, 2017, what should we expect as far as the road ministry is concerned?
I think you have already highlighted the various steps that we've taken in our ministry, say, to revive these so-called stalled projects and to introduce new modes of investment. So I think we will continue. We have been, the finance ministry has been extraordinarily generous to us in terms of
giving a budget. But not generous enough. I know that you've made a proposal seeking more funds and they've said no to you. Is my information correct or
no,
sir?
No. You see, our demands are somewhat, we are always asking for more, but it also is
like Oliver Twist.
Absolutely. And so I think, we've been very well favored by the Ministry of Finance, and we are committed to deliver on all counts in terms of investment, in terms of road length, in terms of all other initiatives that we're going to take. In addition, on the road sector, we have this new model, a hybrid annuity model, and the recent decision of the government to revive the construction industry by freeing up the sums stuck in arbitration awards. These two will have a very definite positive impact.
Are you already seeing the implications, especially as far as the arbitration awards are concerned? Is it already translating into a pickup that you're seeing within the sector?
We've just finished our documentation part. We've started, we are in talks with our, private sector partners. Some cases have been processed, but it's too early to say that, immediately there's been an uptick in whatever they're doing. But we've started the process, and I think there is a very positive feeling. And, we are tendering out large number of projects across the country, and there has been substantial interest and substantial participation continued through October, November, and in this part of December that we are in.
Some of the changes that you've made have aided private developers to come back into the sector, so to speak. But given the fact that, banks and the NPA situation continues to be severe, are you seeing the enthusiasm within the private sector returning, the animal spirit, so to speak, particularly within this sector returning?
I don't know about animal spirits. Green shoots are there, the evidence is there, and I think we are doing reasonably well. And the private sector has been more than cooperative in coming ahead and in investing. There was an issue of risk rebalancing, which the Honorable Finance Minister had addressed in his budget speech. And we went ahead and took his views ahead and made this hybrid annuity model where there's a lot of interest, I might add. And a lot of projects have picked up. I could give you the numbers.
Sure. While you look for that, let me...
We had 33 national highway projects with an aggregate length of 1,800 kilometers and involving a cost of nearly 30,000 crores have been awarded, and a substantial number have achieved financial closure.
Okay. So
things are positive.
So in terms of road length, what is the target for 2017 or FY18?
2016-17, the targets Mr. Gadkari had set us, award targets of 25,000 kilometers. Mr. Arun Jaitley was kinder when he said we have to actually construct 10,000. So we'll try and do both.
So will the truth lie somewhere in between?
No. One is awards and other is actual construction.
Yes.
There's a difference. So we'll try and do construction of 10,000 and we'll try and get close to Mr. Gadkari's target, hard target of 25,000 kilometers.
Okay. Ramesh, Abhishek, let me ask you, sir. You know, we've had some disappointment, even though there's been a lot of work that the government has done on the ease of doing business. But there has been disappointment because we haven't really moved up the rankings, at least as far as the World Bank is concerned. But I think what is more interesting today is what you're doing with states. And this whole business of federal competitiveness is actually playing out in the DIPP state-wise rankings. Does that give you confidence that we are actually going to be able to move the agenda much faster when it comes to the ease of doing business?
See, on ease of doing business front, we are working with the states, as you have mentioned. 12 states have achieved more than 91% score on our 340-point action plan. And there is a huge competition among states to do better and still better, which is very positive. On the central government side, we are working on the World Bank 10 parameters, as well as a lot of other issues and parameters. Hmm. See, the World Bank doing business report only looks at some of the parameters, but the ease of doing business is across every sector, every ministry, and regulators. So we are looking at all those issues. As a matter of fact, in the last 2 years, on giving electricity, we have made a progress jump of 111 points. Yeah. As a matter of fact, we have made plans so that next year, we made similar jumps in almost every parameter.
Sure.
But some of these things take time. Mm. Many of the things that have been done, it takes time for the users to actually realize and feel that those have been done. And World Bank rankings are based on the user feedback. So now we are working on that also. So I think next year you can see a substantial improvement in almost all the parameters.
So what are the priority areas that you want to address in order for us to be able to significantly move up the rankings?
See, for example, starting business right now, it takes 26 days. We have planned that it should take only 5 days which we are planning to do that by May. And there are a whole lot of processes are being curtailed. For example, Ministry of Corporate Affairs have come up with a form, eSpice, replacing all the other forms for incorporation. Similarly, EPFO, ESIC processes are being merged. PAN and TAN, we are planning that it should be given on the same day. And all these processes hopefully should be done by through the eBiz portal in 1 day.
Okay.
That is the ambitious plan that we have. Mm. Similar plans we have for construction permits. We have online systems now in Delhi, Mumbai, and a lot of states. But since these were done in April and May this year, many of the users had not used the system. But now we are going to make sure that these systems are used, and also any feedback that we get is actually reflected. So whether it's trading across borders or is enforcement of contract, insolvency and bankruptcy code implementation is on track. So all these things are going to get reflected in our next year's rankings.
How confident do you feel about continuing to bring in FDI, sir? We've had a good run rate so far, particularly for this year. How confident do you feel to continue and sustain that kind of momentum?
See, we have seen a 30% increase in FDI during this current financial year. In the last two financial years, we got more than $100 billion. So in the last 2.5 years, actually, we got $130 billion of FDI, which is a complete record. And we are seeing huge amount of interest. So the growth that we are seeing, even the October numbers have come, they are also about 25% higher compared to the last year's October numbers, which were also pretty high at about $5.5 billion. So we are seeing huge amount of interest in FDI. So, I mean,
any sectors in specific that you would like to nurture further? Any sectors in specific that perhaps require tweaking in order for big ticket FDI to come in? I'll give you just one example and elicit a comment from you. You know, big noise around opening up foreign direct investment up to 100% into food retail. But we haven't actually seen any money coming into the sector because the demand is that don't just open it up for food retail, allow us to do other kinds of retail as well within that umbrella of food retail. I know the food processing ministry is pressing on the DIPP as well as the Prime Minister's office to change or tweak those rules. Can we expect tweaking in certain sectors that have already been opened up to ensure that what's open means the dollars actually come in?
See, some of the sectors that have seen huge amount of traction in inflows are electronics and software and hardware sector, auto sector, and then, so e-commerce, some of these areas have attracted a lot of investment and interest, and construction, of course. So far as the FDI in retail of food product is concerned, we have done this tweaking only in June this year.
Yeah.
And I am aware that many of the companies are making plans. So, because this is an important policy decision that was taken. So, we are seeing a lot of interest. But of course, FDI policy making is a work in progress. And as and when we get feedback about what more we should do, we keep working on it.
A quick question before I come to Mr. Mishra. On the Make in India policy as well, sir, because that's now been in existence for a little over 2 years. Our last conversation, you did seem to allude that perhaps it will require a certain degree of tweaking to make it even more robust. Make in India, what can we expect now?
See, Make in India plans we had made in December 2014. And naturally, many of those things have got done. Many of the things need revision. Many new action points are to be added, which we are doing now. As a matter of fact, we have brought out 8 sector reports about what has actually happened in Make in India in last 2 years. So enormous amount of work has been done. And those sectoral reports that we have in public domain now on our website shows the kind of work that has been done. And we are also bringing out similar reports in other sectors. And we are continuously updating these plans.
Okay.
So ease of doing business or skill development by the ministry, our FDI policies and our infrastructure development and specific tax interventions, all these are being done to make it much more effective than what it is.
Okay, Mr. Mishra, let me come to you now, sir. You know, we just heard from Sanjay Mitra saying that the finance ministry has always been generous to their ministry. I don't think that your ministry can say the same. At least over the past 2 years, we've actually seen a cut as far as the health budget is concerned. You know, year after year, people talk about the economic benefits of actually investing much more in health. We have the lowest rate or amongst the lowest rates as far as the OECD countries are concerned when we talk about government expenditure on healthcare. Should we really expect any change, any meaningful change as far as the healthcare budget is concerned? Or do you think that we now have to think of innovative ways of bringing capital into this space?
First and foremost, about the perception. If I can't be as generous as Mr. Mitra, let me at least be fair and say that the finance ministry has not been unfair to it. Now, health requirements will never come to an end. It's because traditionally we've been investing very low in health. But when we talk about investments in health, please let us remember that it's not just public investment in health.
Sure.
When we talk about 4.5% of the GDP of a total spend in health,
yeah,
only 1.04% is public spend.
Yeah.
And also let us remember that in this country, close to 60% people are going to the private sector.
Yeah.
Therefore, the stimulus in more investment in health will certainly have to come from the public sector as well, because primary health care is a basic prime responsibility of government and we'll have to keep continue to keep investing. But then we will also have to look at innovative ways of financing health schemes, which means a greater involvement of private sector, a larger amount of investment coming not just in the tertiary health care, but also in the intermediary and the primary healthcare. So if that happens, perhaps we can do it. But yes, there is a demand from both the states as well as the center to invest more and more in health.
So how do you create this pull factor, sir? And I'll give you, you know, I think for as long as I can remember, every year around the budget, captains of Indian industry, specifically representing the healthcare space, will talk about the need for infrastructure status. That hasn't happened so far. If we're talking about out-of-the-box ideas, we're talking about innovative ways of trying to pool in private capital into the healthcare space. How do we get it done? What can we realistically expect now over the next 12 to 18 months, for instance?
See, it's not just about the fiscal play. It's also about a collaborative effort in health financing. For example, if we are able to create a robust platform with government coming up front as an enabler to actually get finances into the system which already exists,
yes,
and actually converge with the national priorities of government, then private funding makes far more sense than it would as a standalone basis. Therefore, the need of the hour is to actually create that robust platform. For example, let me give you one example. We've been talking of PPP for a long time,
yes,
and I've been interacting with many people who are here in this hall on that. We've not been able to, so far, create a robust TOR which is acceptable mutually.
Why is that? Is it because of a trust deficit? Is it because objectives for the private sector are largely driven by commercial objectives, fair enough, and the government's objectives are different and hence there is no alignment?
A, not entirely trust deficit, maybe partly. Let's begin by facing facts. If you want to solve a solution, first recognize it. I mean, for solve a problem, first recognize it. One of the reasons why this has not happened is, unlike the infrastructure sector, the health sector is an extremely complex operation. It's not a straight build, operate, and hand over. It's a more complex thing in terms of investing and getting returns on investment. Mm. I mean, no private sector investment is going to come to you if there is no return on investment. What is really happening is that we are not able to create a framework which fits in the aspirations of both sides.
Mm.
The government would ideally like affordable healthcare to be available to everyone.
Yeah.
But the cost of healthcare, I mean, unless we find a way of reducing that, this doesn't seem to be happening. But just to tell you, and for the last 2 months or so, we've been working very hard on this and we seem to have cracked it finally.
Okay.
Because there are four groups and FICCI is a part of it, which is working intensely on this, on creating a framework where actually the investment can converge at one point of time.
Okay.
If that happens and that grows, healthcare spend will be much better.
So when should we expect a rollout, an announcement? What should we expect?
I don't think we really need to announce. We'll just move along. And I think it's
happening. So when do you move?
How many days in this year left? I don't think I can do it this year, but certainly beginning of next year.
Beginning of next year. All right. So I have you tied down to a timeline. Mr. Lavasa, let me come back to you and ask you for a timeline, sir. The winter session is over. We've seen the winter session close today. Both houses adjourn sine die. The GST bill has not made it to the winter session. The expectation is that if the GST council were to finalize the draft legislation, it will be taken up in the budget session. Is that a fair expectation?
Absolutely right. It's a fair expectation, and I think the Ministry of Finance is working with the state governments to sort out just one or two issues which are
dual left. Control. Is there a breakthrough or not? Because so far we haven't seen either the center or the states give in to each other's demands. So realistically, what is the way forward on the issue of dual control?
Actually, it is not so much as giving in to each other's demand. I think you have to craft an arrangement which is fair to the people and to the assessees. And I'm sure that the assessees would also like that there is a complete transparency in the arrangement. And they are not subjected to ambiguous arrangements. So that is the intent of the Government of India, what we have put on the table for the state's consideration. And I must say that most of the states do understand that the arrangement which Government of India is proposing is fair. So I think a little bit of discussion hopefully should get us there.
Okay, but is a 1st April 2017 timeline still realistic? Because if I go by the Prime Minister's tweet, which he tweeted, I think it was yesterday or day before yesterday, he said, we hope that the GST will roll out in 2017. There was no 1st of April. I don't know whether that was a deliberate miss or it was not a deliberate miss, but 1st of April 2017, a realistic timeline. The state finance ministers, at least some of them, don't seem to believe so.
1st of April is a part of 2017.
Mm-hmm.
And see, all effort.
So is September and so is July.
All effort is towards reaching a consensus as early as possible. But if there are viewpoints which are extremely strong and intractable, then we'll have to deal with the situation accordingly.
Mm. But there is a constitutional compulsion that you will need to roll out the GST before September because states will lose the power to levy VAT come September. So realistically, if it's not April, would July be the next sort of rollout timeline?
Well, as you yourself said, that 1st September or September does present some kind of a deadline. So we have to get there before that to avoid any constitutional confusion. But having said that, I do hold that we are still making efforts and we are hopeful that we should stick to the 1st April deadline.
Mr. Lavasa, I know a lot of people in this room and perhaps a lot of them have sent in their representations already to the Finance Ministry, sir, and everyone is waiting for the Committee of Secretaries to finalize the classification and on rates, sir. When can we expect the finalization as far as rate classification is concerned?
It will happen before the GST is finalized.
So you're not like Mr. Mishra, you're not telling us that it'll be a done deal come the first week of January or at least the start of January.
Well, he's in better health than I am.
Okay, let me break and take a few questions and then come back to the secretaries. I'd request you to raise your hands if you do have a question for our panel here, and we'll try and get a microphone across to you. Anybody here with a question for any of our panelists? Not so, yes, there is a gentleman there. Yes, sir, if you can stand up, we'll just try and get you a mic and then you can ask your question. Go ahead.
I'm Jay Kras, the executive member of FICCI. Sir, on the ease of business, unfortunately, the state's ease of business, Andhra and Telangana is becoming number one. Fine, it is become as a state-wise. But here, the major point here is, ease of business should be major obstacles around the state government and their policies.
Hmm.
How come rather DAPP can help these ease of business, the state governments can ease really doing the business, especially okay. for MSME.
Name and shame, Mr. Abhishek, is that the way forward?
See, the ease of doing business or lack of it affects MSME far more than it does the big business. So we are completely aware of that. And most of the, if you see the 340 parameters that we have, most of them actually address the issues of MSME and small business. So we are very careful about that. And we are again now evaluating what more parameter we should add or change from there. And from this next year, our assessment or evaluation of the states will depend entirely on public feedback. See, so far, we have only looked at the circulars, laws, etc., made by the states, single window technology-driven systems. But from next year, it will be based purely 100% on public feedback.
Okay.
So that's a big change that we are making, because we realize that unless the public feel the change, they realize the change, I mean, you can't really give credit. So the states are also on board on that. And we are determined to see that the small businesses, small industries, MSME, are actually freed from these complex systems which have come in all these decades, Inspector Raj, and all the harassment that people go through. We are totally determined to get rid of that in collaboration with the states.
Ms. Lavasa?
But let me also sort of respond to what you're saying. See, ultimately, it does matter how the state governments are dealing with regulations and approvals and the ease of doing business and the competition that Department of Industrial Promotion has instilled among the states. I think it's paying dividends. But let me give you one specific example. The notification that has been issued by the Ministry of Environment a couple of days ago on environment clearance for building approvals.
Yes.
Now, as we all know that under the Environment Impact Assessment Regulation, the building approvals, as far as environment was concerned, was to be given by the state. And if you constructed a building of more than 20,000 square meters, then you had to apply separately for environment clearance. In a very landmark decision, which has taken over a year to finalize, the new notification which has been issued, it integrates environment clearances with the building approval procedure. So the Ministry of Environment in one stroke has actually done away with the necessity of seeking separate environment clearance for construction activities up to a certain level.
Sure.
So I think these are the I mean, this is just one example where Government of India can also play a part where at the cutting edge level at this in the state governments, difference can be made.
Okay. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Vinay Sheel, Oberoi, the Secretary of the Department of Higher Education, the Ministry of Human Resource Development. Thank you very much for joining us here on this panel, sir. You've got to play catch up because we've been doing this for the last 15 odd minutes. So let me start by asking you about what the priorities are going to be for you specifically in 2017. We're pretty much at the end of calendar year 2016. You're working on a new education policy to start with. What should we realistically expect in 2017 from your ministry?
Right. Well, that's really sort of getting into the hot seat as you come in. We have three major sort of areas, priority areas. One is access. That is increasing access of students to higher education. We are one of the countries which is below 25%. Building infrastructure, very is a possibility, but we would be expanding the range of online, including MOOCs and other courses, which would allow greater access to students. We continue to work on equity, and the challenges are to ensure that students, irrespective of background, of communication, of language, are able to cope with the courses, are able to cope with the workload, but most importantly is quality. And I think that's the area that you're going to see a major focus. And in quality, it's not just about building better institutions, more qualified faculty, but in some way, the outcomes. Employability is a very major concern, that students who come out, integration of skill and higher education, you know, the interoperability. You need to have students who can move from one to the other stream. You need to have students who are skilled enough to take up jobs as they come out of the educational system. And most importantly, research. The kind of research that we do, the impact of that research, the acceptability of that research to not only academia, but equally to industry. And that's going to be a very, very major focus. So I would put it in these three categories. On each of them, I think there are specifics that would unfurl and unfold as we go through the year.
You know, that's a tall ask and a tall task for your ministry, sir. So let me try and break this down into specifics, if I may. And let me start by asking you what you spoke about, which is bridging the skill gap and, you know, looking at the future when we talk about a world of automation, we talk about a world of 3D printing. We're in a country that needs to create jobs. We're not creating jobs, nowhere close to the kind of jobs that we need to create. What is the imperative going to be in terms of de-skilling, reskilling, and what is the action agenda on that front going forward?
Let me begin with the integration of skilling in higher education. We would be encouraging longer term skilling courses, not just the short certificate, 3 and 6 weeks, but going ahead to, let me say, 9 months or even a year, where there is academic content behind the skilling. It's not enough to produce, let me say, an electrician or a plumber. They're very useful. But you need to have the content, you need to have the depth to make him or her a much better electrician or plumber. Secondly, the formal education system itself, or let me call it the conventional educational system, would be providing both space and opportunity. We hope to, in the next, in a very short period of time, the excess capacity in our technical institutions to be used for skilling. And we, you know, because there is a lot of equipment, excess capacity, faculties that are available. So all in all, I'm looking at much, much more integration of these systems. Insofar as employability is concerned, we're really undertaking reviews through the higher education system that you need to look at your curriculum and syllabi. And we have actually passed a regulation which requires them to review both every 3 years, but certainly this year to make sure that these conform to whatever the current market or other requirements are.
Well, like Mr. Mishra here, you will, I would imagine, have to co-opt the men and women sitting in this room to be able to achieve the kind of objectives that you've just articulated here for us. So what is the role that you see of the private sector? What is it that you would expect from them? What is it that you would like them to put on the table?
Yeah, I mean, firstly, we don't see them as just users of skill. I mean, we see them as partners in this.
Collaborators, yeah.
Well, collaborators, if you will. And already the Ministry of Skill, MSD, I don't know if they're here, have been working towards that in terms of bringing them into the skilling process itself. On our part, we begin with the curriculum, as I said, and the syllabi, that is the orienting or reorienting, if you would call it that. We're also providing for adjunct faculty to come in. An adjunct faculty is where people with years of experience in industry, chemical engineering or whatever, to come into the institutions and teach, not just not deliver a lecture or two, but to actually take credits, for instance, to be able to deliver an entire credit course, maybe a semester, maybe that's a distant order today, certainly a credit.
Okay. Mr. Mishra, let me come back to you, sir, and I'll put this question to each of our secretaries here now, since we're talking about the road ahead. In terms of regulatory action, in terms of regulatory reform, what is it that you would like to see? Because especially as far as the pharma and the healthcare space is concerned, I think for the longest time, there has been a call for reforming the Drugs and Cosmetics Act, which is antiquated, if I could put that mildly. I think there has been a call to try and reform the NPPA, and this has been a demand that industry has put forward for very, very long. Are we anywhere close to moving towards these kind of reforms?
Pretty close. See,
January? Is that close enough?
Let me give that date. You see, when we started speaking about, let's say, the Drugs and Cosmetics Act or the NPPA or any pharma-related issues. And pharma, of course, one of the major critical part with the industry was facing was pharma was clubbed with devices.
Yeah.
We've at least successfully done that we're treating devices separately now. See, reforms will not happen immediately or in a day. But if you look at, I would give you a very short window of the last 6 months. Mm. The kind of movement towards reform that has happened in the last 6 months, and thanks also to the industry, because every step that we've taken is in consultation with them. Just one reform I'll mention, for example, the application process to the drug controller. With the new online process of Sugam, the time cut down is more than 3 months immediately upfront. Similarly, there are many, many antiquated requirements which were there, which we are doing away with. But doing rules, regulation, and act amendments is a time-consuming thing. Mm-hmm. But at least as on date, I can tell you that the roadmap is ready. We really know where we are moving.
For the Drugs and Cosmetics Act.
Drugs and Cosmetics Act, the roadmap is ready. The amendment roadmap is ready. The rules for devices have already been put out. The rules for drugs, the many amendments that we are making have already been put out. They're all in public domain now. So the movement is there.
So does this align us then to global,
The idea is to harmonize. The idea is to harmonize. That is the principle that we are
holding. So you spoke about being ready with the amendments to the Drugs and Cosmetics Act. What about the NPPA, sir? There's been a lot of talk about reforming the NPPA. Is that likely? Is it on the cards? How soon, if at all?
See, NPPA's limited role is in fixation of drug prices. The call that has to be taken at a larger level is how much of it do we need? Let me be upfront. It would be wrong as a premise to say that we need to have no price control on drugs. Something that has to be made affordable must be made affordable. And we must try and work within that principle. But there are, every drug that is in the National Essential Drug List need not necessarily be price controlled. But there are some critical drugs we'll have to work on. The issue I personally feel what hurts more is not the control of price, the mechanism. Hmm. And that is where the reform is required to make it.
It'll be less ad hoc and more consultative. Is that going to be the way forward?
Sorry?
Is it going to be more consultative and less ad hoc? Because the complaint from industry has been that drugs are moved into the essential drug list without any consultation, without any transition period, and so on and so forth. Can we make this process more transparent?
No.
Is that
the,
what
the process of picking up a drug to be included in the essential drug list and the consequential price control are two completely different things. We need to consult industry on the prices of drug. Mm-hmm. But the need for a drug to go into the essential drug list for use by public facilities is a completely different ball.
Okay. So
the consultation is happening on the other side, the pharma side, to see how best we can minimize the processes of price fixation and what should be the minimum number of drugs which we really need
to control. So more liberal price control regime?
Perhaps.
Perhaps. It's still a question mark.
No.
I mean, perhaps does not necessarily carry a question mark.
I'm just clarifying. I'm just clarifying. Okay. All right. Let me move across to Sanjay Mitra now. And so let me ask you, in terms of the regulatory reforms that you would like to see, we've seen some forward movement. And in fact, this sector perhaps has been one of the sectors that has outperformed in terms of the changes that have happened over the past 2 years. Pending regulatory reforms, interventions from a policy point of view that we should expect and that you would like to see?
The big one is that we intend to continue our simplification of our the model concession agreement for PPP. We've already taken a large number of steps, simplified and streamlined the process. But the finance ministry is working on an overall umbrella program for a PPP renegotiation framework. The work is there fairly advanced, and that will enable us to unlock the a larger number of stalled projects, because...
What is the quantum of stalled projects today, sir?
It was 73 in 2014. It's down to about early double figures now. It changes depending on how well the concessionaire is doing in terms of his other portfolio, with his relationship with the bankers on a larger canvas. But it's come down sharply, and we hope to keep working on them till such time we reduce them to zero. That's never going to happen, because soon one or the other concessionaire or partner will have problems with the financial institutions. First is this: we would like to work and go ahead with the under the finance ministry's guidelines to have a PPP renegotiation package. The other one was which I mentioned earlier, was the concessions to the construction industry in view of the need to free up their blocked money in arbitration awards. One big initiative that we have taken, which follows up on the FM's budget speech last year or this year, which was to deregulate the transport sector.
Mm.
So far, we have not really looked at the transport sector with the kind of attention and kind of care that it calls for. It's a huge sector, huge employment, huge amount of investment, and cuts nationwide. So this one was, the permit raj in the transport sector is actually quite pervasive.
Mm-hmm.
And it is built into the Motor Vehicles Act, which is a central act. We've just put our amendment in the parliament. It has gone to a standing committee. And we hope to provide the states, individual states, because the action is at the states, the wherewithal to open up their transport sectors. The other big initiative, so you see, we could be looking at co-location of all the checkpoints at the interstate borders. And similarly, opening up the Bangladesh-Bhutan-India network,
mm-hmm.
a transport agreement which will allow free movement of goods and passengers across these international borders. Bhutan had some problems ratifying it, but I understand that the government is working on it. Bangladesh, India, and Nepal have already ratified. And once that comes through, particularly from the eastern part of India, there'll be the growth in trade, international trade, could be absolutely enormous.
Okay. I just want to get a quick word in, because you talked about transportation, and I think one of the big issues, and especially for people here in Delhi, is the issue of pollution, and it's a nationwide concern. We are moving towards tighter emission standards starting 2017. Now, I understand that there is a difference of opinion between the committee that's been appointed by the Supreme Court to look at this matter and the government on whether BS3 vehicles should, the sale of BS3 vehicles should be stopped come the 1st of April 2017, or those should be allowed to continue. Is there a point of view that the government has?
No, that question is probably better addressed to the Environment Department. And since we are we kind of regulate the vehicle standards. Once the norms are set by the Environment Department, my colleague in the Environment Department will be better placed to answer this.
Okay.
We are taking up, just for the information of the House, an interesting initiative in collaboration with the Ministry of Heavy Industry and Ministry of Environment. This is about vehicle scrapping. So this is overdue. Old vehicles, more than 15 years old, that are going to be phased out. So we are working on this. This will call for some sacrifices on part of the auto, on the original equipment manufacturers, some kind of resale value of the scrap. So this is quite an elaborate thing that is going to be set up, elaborate architecture, including setting up a modern scrap yard, things like that. If that comes through, that will have some impact on the
pollution. What is the realistic expectation in terms of a timeline for the scrappage policy? Because it's been going back and forth for very long. You wanted incentives that the finance ministry wasn't generous enough to provide you. So what can we expect now in terms of the scrappage policy?
I wish I could give you a timeline, but we're still working on it. There are many issues that need to be ironed out, particularly after GST. Even if Mr. Lavasa wants to be generous, He has to take it to the GST Council.
Yes.
So it's going to, you know, we have to work on it. But it's something that has attracted attention and the focus is there on this policy.
Okay.
Thank you.
Ms. Abhishek, interventions, regulatory reform, new policies, what should we expect from you, sir? And what was it that you would like to do?
You know, in the last 2.5 years, regulatory reforms and process and simplification, ease of doing business has been one of the biggest achievements of the government. And we have a long agenda and long list, actually, of what we want to do. For example, reforms in Drug and Cosmetics Act is one of the things that is on our agenda for which we are working with Ministry of Health and Ministry of Pharmaceuticals. And there's a very long list, actually. Mm-hmm. On FDI, there are so many FDI policies which have been made, but then many of the sectoral regulations are still not in conformity with our FDI policies. So we are working with the departments
on that. In terms
of
cap, I think the only large sector where the cap continues to be at 26% is broadcast media. Yeah. So any chance that you're likely to relax the cap as far as foreign direct investment in broadcast media is concerned?
Yeah, I mean, I was more hinting at the kind of reforms which have already been done, but the sectoral regulations are not in conformity with what has already been done.
Sure.
So while many of the restrictions are still there, and this is a very short list now, so we are trying to work with the concerned ministries on that. On startups, we have a long list of about 40 odd reforms that we want to do in various laws, regulations. We are also working on how to develop the e-commerce sector. A whole lot of ideas are coming up in that also. So the committee working on that. And virtually there's issues with every department that we have. We have a long list with almost every department. And we are working very closely on that. And it's good to see that so many things are happening. And many things are work in progress. With states, we have a very long list of EODB reforms that we are working on with them. So virtually, there is nothing that is not being covered by DIPP. So on a day-to-day basis, we are working, because we get regular feedback from investors, foreign and domestic, and our small businesses. So we are actually working on those issues with every ministry and department and regulator also.
Are the foreign investors happier than the domestic investors?
I think this is a question of only, it's a relative issue. You know, they are happier than what they were before, but then they can be happier in future. So I think we need to do a lot, actually.
We need to do a lot. A quick question, sir, on Startup India, because that was the big policy announcement that the DIPP made earlier this year. How much money has been deployed through SIDBI? Because the budget allocation or the announcement spoke of 10,000 crores.
See, right now only a small amount of money was given to them. They are still, their guidelines are in place. They have selected four daughter funds to take equity in. But then many of those things are going to be implemented more and more. SIDBI is also working with venture funds. We need to tweak some of these guidelines. But they have already started implementation of the fund of funds. And there's a credit guarantee scheme of 2,000 crores. That also we are getting the approval of the government for that. So hopefully in the next couple of months, that also will be rolled out.
Okay.
But then our idea of fund of funds was also to basically catalyze investment in the venture fund industry, because we are investing only some amount of that in the daughter funds by way of equity, and much more equity is supposed to be mobilized in the private sector.
Okay.
So we are only, if we invest X, then at least 4X should be deployed in the market.
Okay. So Mr. Lavasa, as far as you're concerned, the next big ticket item is the budget on the 1st of February. You will be in breach of privilege, sir, if you give us a sense of what we should expect. But if you can sort of, cloak it in the vicinity of this big bang stimulus that everyone seems to be talking about and seems to be expecting, how easy is it going to be? Do you have the fiscal space and the fiscal room? Because the Reserve Bank, at least as of now, says that it's not going to be able to provide you that bonanza.
First of all, I would like to compliment you, Shireen, for trying to provoke all my colleagues. And I must compliment them for very steadfast belief in the generosity of the finance ministry. But generosity in the finance ministry is not necessarily a virtue.
Mm-hmm.
Because even if you have the Oliver Twist asking for more, finance ministry doesn't bumble around with its finances. You see, I think 25 years after the economic reforms liberalization process was started, it is time for us to actually focus on what is it that will take us to the next level.
Yeah.
We've already achieved some kind of transformation of our economy. And from a low-income country, we've now moved into the middle range. And we must carefully look at what are the sectors, what are the concerns which we need to address, which will take us to the next level.
Mm-hmm.
And I think 3-4 areas clearly stand out, apart from the several initiatives for improving governance.
Sure.
Which in any case is the prerequisite for anything to succeed. But going forward, I think we need to focus a lot on how to boost our agriculture income,
mm-hmm.
how to revive growth in the agriculture sector. We need to look at creating employment in a big way and focus on sectors which have greater employability.
Mm-hmm.
The third thing which I would like to mention is that the rapid pace at which urbanization is taking place in India, I think if it is not managed properly, it can lead to huge costs to the economy. And going forward, everybody and anybody who's involved in economic development, because urbanization happens to be a necessary corollary of economic growth. So we will have to manage our urban growth in such a way that it leads to better environment, and the need for managing the environment is embedded in the way in which we manage our urbanization. Having said this, I think there is also a need to provide a stimulus to private investment in the country. So whether it is the small and medium sector or it is other types of investment, we need to take steps by which the animal spirit that you were talking about is revived. But certainly, we don't want the kind of vile behavior which some of the investors in the past their investments and their decisions were perhaps so aggressive that it has caused problems not only for themselves, but for the economy at large.
One of the problems that led to this sort of crazy diversification and the broken private sector balance sheets that we're now dealing with was that money was cheap, liquidity was easy, but the government is actually hoping that that's going to be the scenario with the banks being flushed with deposits and so on and so forth, that we are going to move into a much more accommodative interest rate regime.
Well, I think excess liquidity or availability of easy finance necessarily should not lead to irrational behavior.
Sure.
So the point which I am trying to make is that as we go forward, investment decisions should be based on a very rational and cool calculation of returns and not predicated upon the ability to change course as we go along. So the kind of difficulties which Secretary Road Transport is referring to, where you run into hundreds of projects which become stranded because there was aggressive decision making by the private investors, I think all of us are better off if a more moderate and more reason-based, assessment-based decisions are taken, even if business is known to take risks.
Sure. That is the primary job of business, but I would imagine that rational risk-taking is the need of the hour at this point in time. But Mr. Lavasa, before I get closing comments from you, beyond the budget, sir, in terms of legislative action, are we done for now? You believe that a large chunk of the legislative action post the GST for now is done, or are we likely to see, you've done bankruptcy, you've done GST more or less, at least the first leg. What else is remaining on the legislative calendar?
Well, one, of course, clearly is the balance legislation which is associated with GST.
GST, yeah.
So that will have to come. And the renegotiation of contracts, if that is, that requires a legislation, or whether it is possible to accommodate within the existing provisions of law, this is something which needs to be studied, because everybody recognizes that long-term contracts, 25 years, 30 years, they do throw up unforeseen eventualities which require the parties to sit down and renegotiate. So if that requires a legislation, that of course...
Do we need any legislation post the 8th of November to factor in demonetization, whether it's of the Reserve Bank Act or any sort of associated legislation at all?
Well, we have not thought of anything, but if you have some great ideas, we are willing to look at
it. I have none, so I'm just checking if there is any talk or any possibility of going down that road.
No, I'm not hiding anything, but there is nothing.
Okay, excellent. And Mr. Oberoi, let me ask you, sir, you've given us a sense or a glimpse of what we should expect in terms of the big ticket ideas. Any broad timelines, any targets that you've set for yourself within this overarching vision that you've painted for us?
Yeah, I mean, some are reasonably sort of evident. You're moving towards a much higher gross enrollment ratio. So I think each year we should be adding a percent, in fact, 1.5% to that. Secondly, there are clearly some areas in which the directions have been set. So we hope to be able to launch the massive open online courses. You know, that's now reasonably imminent, I think, a lot of the spade work. And that is not a secret. I mean, that's something that's
right.
been... And of course, I think we need to be looking very seriously at the research and the research partnerships and the framework in which the research is. So I think these would be the areas of concentration in the next...
Okay, so wrap up comments. Your number one... challenge and your number one opportunity on your dashboard today?
Absolutely quality, meaning that's the area...
Opportunity and challenge both.
It's an opportunity, and I think that our institutions, our educational institutions, are now well aware of that, and they're working in their own ways. More importantly, they're working with each other. So I think it's a challenge, but I think you're going to see a framework evolve. You're going to see much more research happen over the next... year or two.
Okay.
Of course, research is a long-term thing, but you initiate it.
Okay. So, let me put the same question to you, sir. Number one opportunity and number one challenge on your dashboard.
I guess the biggest challenge that I would see today is actually doing a very good job on providing a very robust primary healthcare in the country. And the opportunity that I see presently is the kind of interest that is generating, not just in industry, but everywhere. So we need to tap that to get this goal done.
What about universal health care, sir? That was a promise made by the government.
Yes, universal health care is not a standalone program in itself. If you can get a robust primary health care with free drugs, free diagnostics, and a universal screening to save on tertiary care, your universal health care program is done.
By
you
when?
You need not call it. This timeline, nobody can give you. Because you see, I mean, let me just, now that you've said it, we always seem to be seeing what we have not been able to do. As a country, we have forgotten to celebrate success. If India today is declining at a rate faster than the globe in its maternal mortality and infant mortality,
yeah.
with the meager investment you've made, you can imagine what the situation is going to be if you increase, step up investment and focus your primary health care.
Sure.
So that is my case. And I don't see why in the next 3 to 4 years we should have such a good, robust primary health care that we are actually talking of health care and not of hospital care.
Well, I wish you very, very well, sir, and I hope that you are able to achieve that objective, because I think that could be perhaps one of the biggest game changers that this country will see.
I guess, yes, it will be. And we need to make that happen.
wish you all the very best, sir. Let me ask you, sir, the number one opportunity and the number one challenge.
The number one challenge is to meet the very stiff target set us by the minister and the our minister and the finance minister in terms of roads, in terms of actual infrastructure creation. And the opportunity is the opportunity once the Motor Vehicle Act is passed to ensure road safety, which is a huge concern now. We're losing 1.5 lakh people every year. And to also ensure seamless travel by opening up the transport sector.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And again, to you as well, sir. We wish you all the very best with that. Mr. Abhishek.
Our main challenge is to improve ease of doing business in the country. And our opportunity is that we have a government which is not only committed to creating a very business-friendly climate, but also is determined to do it.
Mr. Lavasa.
Oh, I wish I had only one challenge.
But you can give us a longer list if you like.
No, I think the big challenge before all of us is to work towards social and financial inclusion.
Mm-hmm.
And move towards an environment which is compliance-oriented, in the sense that more and more people should comply with the laws of the land. I think that probably constitutes one of the big challenges before us, and that also is an opportunity for us to work. Purely from the expenditure point of view, I think we would like to work towards achieving greater efficiency of public spending and creating an environment which is participative, both public and private, as far as economic growth is concerned.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very, very much to all the secretaries for joining us here this evening and sharing with us their vision for the road ahead. I think one thing is absolutely clear. As a Greek philosopher said, luck happens when preparation meets opportunity. And I think if you heard each of the secretaries speak here today, I think they're very clear in terms of what the game plan is and how we hope to be able to get there. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts and your vision with us. We appreciate your time. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Well, just a formal thank you. It's not very often that you can get five senior secretaries of the Government of India together on a platform to speak to industry. They are all extremely busy, and with this government, it's very difficult to keep the schedule because of so many things that keep coming up. But I'm really grateful. All of you have honored us with your kind presence. Thank you, Shireen, for very, very gently persuading, nudging, and still they have held fort, and I think they've not revealed too much. So, but thank you very much for doing a stellar job. Thank you.